Hi, you're watching The King of Bling on the Time Team official YouTube channel with me, Tony Robinson. It might not seem it, but this damp piece of unprepossessing scrub is at the heart of one of the most important discoveries in British archaeological history. Just below the surface here, diggers found the tomb of an Anglo-Saxon king crammed with ornate finds from across Europe. And that was just the start of a fascinating detective story. Who was this mysterious king? Archaeologists have spent the last 12 months unpicking this site and poring over the finds, trying to find hidden clues which could reveal the identity of the person who was buried here. And Time Team have been with them all the way. The seaside town of Southend in Essex was launched into the archaeological limelight because of what happened on this small triangle of urban wilderness, sandwiched between a railway line and a busy main road. It seemed like a routine job when a team of diggers arrived here in this suburb of Southend in November 2003. The council wanted to widen the road and the archaeologists had been called in to do an evaluation of the site. Previous construction work here at Prittlewell during the 1890s and 1930s had unearthed a series of high-status Anglo-Saxon warrior graves, and the archaeologists' task was to record and recover any remaining archaeology on the site. It's the kind of work that's bread and butter to archaeology units throughout the country, but all that changed when they put in a trench over here, and suddenly what had been a pretty standard job turned into an urgent, top-secret rescue dig. As suspected, the diggers began to uncover more Anglo-Saxon artifacts. But unlike the previous finds, these were fantastically preserved glass jars, metal bowls, and what looked like gold-rimmed drinking horns.
I think it's absolutely incredible. These items are outstanding, they're of national significance. It's very rare to find these kinds of objects. All of them are very unusual.
It is extremely exciting and incredibly significant. It would just be nice when we can finally get the whole thing out in the open and publicise what we've got here.
This looked like a grave unlike any other discovered on the site. And as the team from the Museum of London's Archaeological Service, MOLA, continued to excavate, it became clear that they'd made an unprecedented find. The diggers had stumbled upon an intact burial chamber.
Essentially, I'm standing in what was a subterranean sort of space. In this corner, you've got this large iron sort of stand. It could well be a candelabra. The grave goods included two gold foil crucifixes, which is the first time that they've been found in this country. We also found a single gold belt buckle. I mean, a stunning object. The large hole in here is where a large Coptic bowl with sort of two loop handles on had been suspended, and that was still hanging in its original position, which is staggering.
The sheer array and quality of the finds was stunning. With so much precious material on site, the diggers had no choice but to increase security and work 7 days a week in an atmosphere of absolute secrecy.
Unfortunately, I mean, a lot of sites do get sort of plundered. So, I mean, although, you know, I'm sort of polite to anyone who might sort of look in the fence and ask me what's going on, obviously it's very non-specific. You know, what we don't say is there's a very rich princely chamber grave out there and there's lots of pots and pans and sort of gold buckles, etc., coming out.
The preservation in the chamber was an archaeologist's dream. Some objects were even in the same position they were the day the tomb was sealed.
The entire chamber originally would have had a timber roof over the top of it, and over that roof there would have been a mound. Now, the roof isn't going to necessarily collapse as a single sort of event, so you've had a gradual sort of, maybe sort of, you know, one timber at a time springing. The effect of that is that you've had a very gradual sort of infilling of the actual sort of chamber, almost like a big egg timer.
This egg timer effect slowly filled the chamber with earth from the burial mound, packing and protecting many of the objects from the eventual collapse of the roof and centuries of environmental wear and tear. The main casualty from 1,400 years of decomposition was the body. On site, the archaeologists found no discernible remains. But painstaking laboratory analysis of the soil in the chamber produced a tantalizing glimpse of the person once buried there.
There's very small fragments of human tooth. There are a couple of pieces that are identifiable to being the crowns of permanent molar teeth.
The back teeth.
The back teeth,
Not enough tooth remained to give the archaeologists DNA or dating evidence, but the crumbs were proof that a body had been buried in this area of the chamber, on a wooden structure, probably a coffin or a bed. The tomb's contents would eventually be handed over to the town's museum to join the finds uncovered from a scattering of Saxon settlements around Southend.
We knew this was part of a cemetery. We have about 16 warrior burials with the weapons, the spears, the shovels and so on. From 1930, we knew that there were some female graves, extremely rich ones, and we assumed that any further excavation was going to reveal perhaps more female graves.
By now, the formal layout of the surviving archaeology suggested a fascinating, even controversial possibility that this was a 7th-century burial chamber of royal status.
I think at the moment, we see the person buried there not as just an ordinary warrior, but obviously a leader of his community, of a wider community than just Prittlewell. The person who obviously saw Prittlewell as his power base and the place to be.
As word spread between a select few archaeologists, it became clear that the burial in this Southend suburb was among the richest Saxon burials ever found in England.
It's probably one of the most important archaeological finds in England of the last 100 years. And it's been international importance because it tells us about the structure of society at a time when historical information is really terribly, terribly rare. So here we have the forensic evidence of the origins of English society. It's tremendously exciting.
That one's been planned. That one's been picked up by geomatics. The one on the right as you stand.
Right.
Slowly but surely, the finds were taken from the Prittlewell tomb to the Museum of London's conservation labs for further work, some as individual items, others as large blocks of earth.
The most protective way of bringing these sort of objects up is to block lift the finds with objects particularly that have lots of different little parts that may well come apart. If you took them up bit by bit, you wouldn't be able to see the whole so easily.
Even with all the finds safely off-site, the discoveries kept coming. At an English heritage facility in Portsmouth, X-rays of one of the blocks lifted revealed the remains of a musical instrument fit for a king.
Goodness gracious. Wow. This is definitely a lyre. I can see that from these features here and here. And this is the first time we've ever seen one of these things in the ground and had the leisure to study it while it's still in the ground, as indeed it still is as we're talking here.
The lyre, a symbol of wealth, patronage and knowledge, was yet another indication of the status the Prittlewell burial had. The excavation at Southend had finished, but the quest to identify the man, possibly the king, who was buried there, had just begun.
If you want us to investigate more sites, you can make it happen. So, help us reach 10,000 members on Patreon.
This press conference.
2 months after the Prittlewell excavation, the discovery of a mysterious royal grave in Southend is announced to the world.
We have had a very rare and very privileged glimpse of life nearly 1,400 years ago.
The first items to be prepared for display demonstrate the wealth of the buried man. All are imported. A flagon from the Eastern Mediterranean, possibly Syria, a gold belt buckle from Kent, and a unique pair of gold crosses. It's not surprising that the haul captures the imagination of the press. But in spite of the headlines, almost nothing's known about the man in the tomb. The challenge for the archaeologists will be to try and establish an identity from the contents of the chamber.
This is really like a little mini excavation, but in the laboratory. We could tell from the shape on the X-ray that it was likely that we had a spoon, and that is what it's proved to be.
It's almost certainly a drinking horn, and we now have two of them.
We have a group of bone or antler game pieces. Backgammon's an obvious thought, or a style of backgammon, but you don't normally have 50 pieces.
If the archaeologists can prove this was the tomb of a king, it will rewrite early English history. And establish Southend at the heart of a kingdom. It's a challenge Mick Aston relishes. How on earth do you start investigating a period that you don't know much about and a person that no one knew existed until last December?
Well, I think the answer is that there are a whole range of specialists in this country and abroad. They probably only know a great deal about one tiny little item or one tiny little aspect of it. But you bring that together with all the expertise they've accumulated over the years, and then you combine it with the next expert and what they know. It's like a river with made up of lots of streams. It all flows together, and in the end you get this volume of material.
The reaction from the archaeological community is in fact overwhelming, with so much interest that special open days have had to be held for archaeologists, academics and historians.
This is silver.
It is silver.
Yeah, you can see
it. So it's a Byzantine spoon. Oh, look at those. Aren't they posh?
At least consider the option, there might have been a bed buried off. But as Ian was saying, this, none of the suspension.
Which gives them the opportunity to examine the grave goods of the most well-preserved and excavated Anglo-Saxon tomb ever discovered.
Well, there's obviously somebody in Essex churning these out. Well, gosh, has it got a Christian inscription?
We don't know yet. We've only just explained
it. With any luck, it'll have a name on it and we'll find out who it is.
The consensus among archaeologists is that every find in the chamber could have a symbolic importance, and that this carefully dressed tomb was a message to the living on how the dead wish to be remembered. Among those trying to wade through this onslaught of information from beyond the grave is Time Team's own Anglo-Saxon expert.
In this very heroic society, right, they're trying to say, I am a mighty warrior, or I'm the kind of person that would be a mighty warrior.
Right.
I am somebody who supplies a feast, and this is the kind of family that we are, and we can afford to put all this stuff into the grave to show you what we are like, and
so
that we are confident to carry on.
So there's a conspicuous consumption element to it as well. We are wealthy, we can write this off.
I think so, yes.
That rather assumes then that it was meant to be seen in the grave. Perhaps people were meant to come and visit the grave before it was filled in.
Yes, definitely. I think that's absolutely what we ought to think of. You'd have had to have people almost filing past.
You go and perhaps pay your last respects to the whoever it is. It's almost a bit like seeing all the wedding gifts at a marriage, isn't it?
Yes.
Sort of, this is the amount of gear we've managed to accrue, you know, for this couple.
The first task for the archaeologists is to establish the buried man's status. If he is a king, there's a much better chance that the scarce historical records may contain a reference to him. And there's certainly little doubt among the visiting specialists that the finds, such as the gaming pieces, represent someone who saw himself as a heroic leader of men.
Why would they have a game like this? I mean, these are chaps with big swords, big helmets, big shields. They're warlike chaps.
Well, it is an extension of war.
Like chess, in fact.
Right, you're reenacting a conflict on a smaller scale, and it's about strategy and thinking ahead, and it's also about power and ordering the universe. All this artwork, all the entwined animals and so on, this is much what we get on other drinking horns, isn't it?
It is, but only the ones in the very high-end graves. We have about, 40 drinking horns all told, and about 20 of those are from England. And of those 20, only a very few, fewer than I would say six, have horn fittings quite this elaborate. This is much more likely, given the size, to be from a wild cattle, from an aurochs. And that would also mean that the horn would be imported, because at this point in time, aurochsen were extinct in the British Isles and had been since the Neolithic, and so the horn would have had to come from Scandinavia as a prestige import, possibly a diplomatic gift.
It's finds like this that have got the archaeologists drawing comparisons between the Prittlewell tomb and the great kingly burials discovered at Broomfield, also in Essex, Taplow in Buckinghamshire, and Sutton Hoo in East Anglia. Broomfield and Taplow were dug in the late 19th century using methods that were less than ideal. Much of the archaeology was destroyed in the process, but the surviving goods suggested that they were the last resting places of unknown early 7th century kings. Sutton Hoo, dug just before the Second World War, fared slightly better. Archaeologists unearthed the richest Saxon burial ever found in this country, commonly believed to be the tomb of the great 7th century king Radwald. Many of the surviving grave goods are now on display in the British Museum, and they could provide the final clue to the status of the man buried at Prittlewell.
Like Taplow, it's got an enormous quantity of vessels, more to vessels, actually, than Taplow. Taplow's got about 19. Prittlewell's got, I think on the last count, about 21 or 22.
But it keeps going up.
Keeps going up. Yeah. I keep losing track. And this quantity of vessels, big storage vessels, buckets, cauldrons, drinking vessels, things for eating and feasting and merrymaking in hall. These are very typical of Sutton Hoo as well as Taplow. They're exactly what a ruler has for his entourage.
Do you think the guy who was buried in our chamber would have considered himself to be a king?
Yes, I do. I do. It's got all the hallmarks with these very exotic imports in the grave, the Byzantine vessels, the folding stool, the Celtic hanging bowl, just like Sutton Hoo with its Byzantine imports and its Celtic things, and the vast quantity of material that's in the grave. Yeah, that's certainly the stuff that rulers were buried with, and I'm quite sure the guy buried at Prittlewell believed he was a king and was recognised as a king.
Prittlewell now has its king, and it would seem a very smart king at that, because establishing a base in 7th century Southend would have been a shrewd move. The area was strategically very important.
This burial is on the Thames estuary, and just around that time, the Thames estuary was becoming very important because of the development of trade with the continent, and a lot of the material we find in this burial and in other burials of this date are coming in from Europe. So in some ways you can say that it's poised on the edge of a world that's becoming reconnected with the continental mainland.
The East Saxon kingdom, the ancestral land of Essex, sat between two of the most important kingdoms in early Saxon Britain. Kent, ruled by Ethelbert, the first English king to become a Christian, and East Anglia, under Radwald. The East Saxon capital was London, with a newly established church and trading settlement, but it would appear that Southend may have been a better place for the king to exert a strong influence over his larger neighbours.
Here we are at the mouth of the Thames, and the person who commanded a key point at the entrance to a river system was clearly in a very strategic position. This burial at Southend, I mean, is clearly somebody who is trying to command control of traffic up and down the Thames.
Establishing that the man buried at Prittlewell is a king, an East Saxon king, is an important step in trying to give him a name, because a king is more likely to have been immortalised by historians than a mere wealthy landowner. The British Library has got the best collection of early historical manuscripts in the country, but the 7th century is at the very beginning of written history in Britain, and records are scarce. Even the most revered text, the work of the 8th century monk Bede, was made a century after the event.
How soon after Bede wrote this would this have been produced?
Well, Bede finished the text in 731, and this is one of the three earliest copies made actually at Bede's Monastery of Jarrow. This one probably in the 750s, as part of the publication drive to get Bede's works out there in Britain and the continent.
Amazingly, there is one brief entry that mentions a Saxon king in Essex in the early 7th century, and it establishes his family links to the all-powerful King Ethelbert of Kent.
Tunc temporis Sebertus nepus Ethelberti et sorore ricula regnabat. So in this time, Sebert, the nephew of Athelbert and his sister Ricula, was reigning in East Saxon territory.
Wow.
So there's
our name.
This isn't necessarily the man who's buried at Prittlewell, but his name, Sebert, does appear in another document, the East Saxon Royal Genealogies.
Also, and there's our man again, look, Sebert and his father Sled, who's the one married to Athelbert's sister Ricula. Which is how the separate manuscripts, completely separately preserved, and yet the genealogical information dovetails perfectly.
So that gives us confidence that we're talking about something real,
yeah,
doesn't it?
Exactly. Yeah.
It's extraordinary, isn't it? These people all seem so mythical to me, and yet you just get these little glimmers of history sticking out of the mirror. Yeah.
We've asked historian Sam Newton to compile a royal family tree from every available archive source, and that should give us a list of possible candidates for the Prittlewell burial. One of the reasons the written archives for this period are so poor is because the Saxons were from an oral tradition. The tales of battles won and the heroic exploits of ancestors were passed on through poems and song, a tradition celebrated by the lyre placed in the burial chamber.
The structure of the instrument as a whole shows up incredibly well. I mean, it looks, with the usual eye of faith, you've got all the important structures present.
Unfortunately, the majority of the instrument was made of wood, which over the centuries rotted away in Prittlewell's damp soil, leaving an intriguing array of metal fixtures.
Maybe it's a reinforcement or even a repair.
Time Team have now commissioned Graham Lawson and instrument craftsman Zachary Taylor to recreate the Prittlewell lyre.
The lyre represented more than just a musical instrument in a society which relied on sound and song and rhyme and chanting for its communication as part of its culture.
You can't begin to understand the music if you have never played the instruments, and you can never really understand the instruments as playing objects if you haven't got to grips with the manufacture process.
Using the x-rays and the shadows and stains in the block lifted from the site, they've managed to draw a 7th century blueprint of the lyre. All Zachary needs to do now is make it. In Cambridge, Sam Newton has completed the family tree he started at the British Library, and his trawl of Bede, the Anglo-Saxon Chronicles and Royal Genealogies has resulted in a list of all the East Saxon kings that lived and died during the 7th century. Somewhere in this lineage could be the name of the king buried at Prittlewell.
This is an absolutely vital document.
So out of all these names, and there's quite a lot here, who do you think are the main protagonists?
Well, the leading suspect is Sebert. Uh-huh. But looking at this, actually, we can't rule out his brother, Syaxa. If the dates prove to be later, it's got to be the three sons of Sebert, Sawad, Saxrad, and possibly Saxbeld. And Bede adds, as they say, that they were killed not long afterwards, which they seem to be about 623, fighting against the West Saxons. Now, Sawad, the eldest, his son, Sigebert the Saint. Sigebert the Saint must also be considered as a suspect if we're talking about a mid-7th century date.
These names have always been in the archives, but the discovery at Southend may mean we can now actually place one of these powerful men into the Saxon landscape. The next challenge for the conservation team is to determine if any of the finds can give a specific date that could connect the burial with a name from the family tree. Frustratingly for a grave containing over 140 separate items, that dating evidence is very thin on the ground. In fact, the best chance for a reliable date probably lies with these two small coins discovered in the tomb.
The full inscription reads, Vitalis Monet, that's the beginning of Moneta, Vitalis the Moneyer. And he's the person issuing the coins, the official responsible for actually making them and getting them out to the public. So they tell us where they were made and who they were issued by.
Presumably the great thing about us having coins is that it means that we can date the burial.
Well, I'd be
very pleased if Gareth can, but I think all the trends over the last few years have been showing that what we thought we knew about early medieval coins, we don't know so much about now.
I think that's absolutely right, yes. The more we study, the less we know.
But surely, I mean, we've got the ruler's face on them, so we know when the ruler was around, so we can date them.
If only it were that easy. What we don't have is a ruler's face. What we have is stylized images, basically copied from a bust of a Byzantine emperor. It tells us nothing about what ruler this coin was actually made for.
The quest for an exact burial date from the archaeology is a dead end. Getting a name for the King of Prittlewell will mean reassessing the grave goods in a completely different way.
So together we brought Time Team back, and now we're going to take Time Team to the next level. Help us achieve 10,000 ongoing members on Patreon.
A Saxon burial mound was much more than just a grave marker. The rebuilt mound at Sutton Hoo is an awe-inspiring reminder of the physical investment in building a memorial that acted as a landmark to navigate by, a symbol of family status and a form of unwritten history, a legacy left in the landscape.
What we've got here is evidence of what are essentially state funerals. So you would have had a lot of willing hands, as much as the guardsmen who had to carry the Queen Mother's coffin or Princess Diana's coffin, which were lead-lined, of course, and took a lot of effort. So you've got that kind of commitment.
Sam has compiled a list of possible kings buried under the Prittlewell mound, and he's now narrowed the choice to three generations of East Saxon royalty that ruled and died in the first half of the 7th century. But the archaeology has so far failed to give a precise date for any single object in the tomb. So attention shifting to what the assemblage of items say about the man buried there. And it seems that one find in particular, a silver Byzantine spoon, could be saying quite a lot.
So you can see that there's the main inscription running down the centre of the bowl of the spoon.
Yes.
And then there's a large cross in the top.
Yes, which is very
area.
Clear.
You
yes.
can see that well, yeah.
This tiny cross, barely visible to the naked eye, has much more significance than its size suggests.
It represents an explicit statement of allegiance to Christianity at a very early date in the conversion of England to Christianity.
So do you think it's written to be seen more by the person who's eating their soup rather than as a kind of general display thing?
I don't think it's a soup spoon, but yes, for whatever they're consuming yes. off it.
Yeah.
The one of the suggestions that's been made is that it may have been intended for use in communion, giving communion wine, communion wafer, which would be a far more important consumption.
In fact, wouldn't that make it our first Christian Latin inscription in England?
Depending on its date.
Yes, yes. All the other ones are not
well, in
Christian.
Terms of datable ones, yes, 685,
yes.
Jarrell yeah. would be, I suppose.
I think this is early, I'm sure this
it
is earlier
must be,
than that.
Yes.
The Christian symbolism of this spoon may be a vital clue, because the three generations of kings who could be buried at Prittlewell had very different attitudes to Christianity. King Sabert was a willing convert and ruled as the first Christian king of Essex until his death in 616. But the first half of the 7th century was a turbulent time, with beliefs and allegiances constantly changing. And Sabert's sons strongly disagreed with their father's conversion.
After 616, it does appear that these Saxon kings are certainly not Christian. And in fact, rather dramatically and rather unfairly on the poor old bishop who's been established there, the three sons of the King Sabert who accepted the bishop there are very pagan. They don't like the bishop, and they say to the bishop, let us try some of that nice white bread you used to feed our father, who they called Saba, meaning the communion wafer. The bishop says, you cannot partake of the holy wafer until you've entered the bath of baptism. And the Essex boys clearly don't like being told when to have a bath, and they tell the bishop so. And
They also say, if you will not avail us of so simple a request as to try some of this white bread, you shall not remain in our kingdom. So the bishop, as the Old English version puts it, was oot a shoven. He was shoved out. And Christianity does not get back into Essex until the 650s, and that is the context for the next Christian king of Essex, whose name is Sigebert.
Determining whether or not the burial is Christian is now crucial to the investigation. The problem is the tomb seems to be full of contradictions. There are plenty of suggestions of Christian belief, such as the spoon, this Coptic bowl, and a flagon that appears to be decorated with images of saints. But there are also ostentatious displays of Anglo-Saxon wealth, such as the game of strategy, elaborate drinking vessels, and the lyre, a symbol of art, poetry, and music. Such a vast hoard of material goods seems to contradict the concept of a simple Christian burial.
The assumption has generally been that you don't take stuff to the other world if you're Christian.
Well, that's true, but people can put grave goods in graves for other reasons.
Right.
There are plenty of examples nowadays, for example, of people putting photographs, toys, or whatever into burials. One could give a lot of examples of that.
Is one possibility that this chap was nominally Christian but still pagan? In other words, he had one foot in each camp at the time.
Right? Not necessarily. I can see nothing in this burial which actually says pagan. I can see plenty that represents ostentatious demonstration of status, a heroic pagan past.
The flagon, bowl and spoon aren't enough proof by themselves that the burial's Christian. They could have simply been expensive gifts from a believer. But together, they make a much stronger argument. And there is one other find that persuades many experts that this was an intentionally Christian burial. These two small, fragile artefacts made of gold foil.
At Prittlewell, we have the crucial evidence of these two gold crosses placed on the upper part of the body.
Right.
Now, it seems to me...
I've never seen anything like that in a burial before, though, John.
Well, not in England. It's unique in England. I've been looking at parallels for the Prittlewell gold crosses, and in this book there are quite a lot of pictures of crosses from the northern Italian area and a few from Spain, and you can see that some of them are really very close to the Prittlewell gold crosses.
I think I would have expected you to have a book full of illustrations of crosses like that, John.
Yeah, well, this is a German monograph entirely about these gold crosses, and in those parts of the continent they're really quite common.
Right.
But the extraordinary thing is that here they should turn up in England.
These two gold crosses were found in the same area of the tomb as the crumbs of teeth and would probably have been laid on the king's eyes. Such a personal display of belief must surely exclude the three pagan brothers from the shortlist of buried kings, leaving just the Christian Sigebert and his grandfather Sabert, who brought Christianity to Essex in the first decade of the 7th century. Sabert's baptism by the Italian Bishop of London, Mellitus, was cause for great rejoicing, and to mark the occasion, a new church, St Paul's, was founded in the East Saxon capital of London. There are conflicting accounts of Sabert's final resting place, although folklore has him being buried at St Paul's after his death in 616. But there could be another lead in Southend at St Mary's, the parish church for Prittlewell, and just half a mile from the tomb. Tucked away in this imposing Norman church is an important bit of Saxon archaeology.
What do you think it is?
Well, I think it's half of a doorway, because this is the site of the original church. The excavations done in the early part of the 20th century show that this is a 7th century wall. And I think there was a building here, perhaps a small minster, because in those days that's the way the church worked, and that was one of the doors.
This doorway, made of reused Roman brick, has been dated to the mid-7th century. Too late for Sabert, but perfect for his grandson Sigebert, also known as Sigebert the Saint, who reintroduced Christianity to pagan Essex in the 650s.
What do you think the relationship would have been then between this church and the person who they found in the burial?
Well, I think he was a founder. Well, I think there's no problem about... I mean, why would he be buried here? I mean, this is an unusual place for a king to be buried unless it was his principal settlement.
My understanding is that historians have always assumed that this was pretty much of a backwater.
True.
Not much was going on here in Saxon times.
But it obviously wasn't. And where did they get the money from? I mean, this whole north wall is pre-conquest. Now, that's enormous, considering the other Saxon churches in the area, which are very small.
Yeah.
And there must have been some reason for it to be so big. And I think royalty, or at least Saxon chiefs, would be the answer.
Does that story sound all right to you?
Yeah.
They're
always other possibilities, aren't they?
Yes, so. But then you've got four archaeologists, you get five opinions.
At least.
As the hunt for a name reaches its final stages, the recreation of the lyre found in the royal burial chamber is also gathering pace. Musicologist and craftsman Zachary Taylor is in the process of recreating the Prittlewell lyre.
The joint, which on each side, as you can see, is what's called an open mortise and tenon. These two joints, because they're a pair, are the most difficult joints I've ever cut.
And it's turning out to be a surprisingly awkward object to make.
The problems associated with the crossbar, which is the piece that connects the two arms, and there were many of them, but primarily a question of grain orientation. Ideally, the grain would go in this direction, on either side where you have tenons for strength. But in fact, despite the large amount of choice I had from many planks of curly-whirly yew, I couldn't find one piece that gave me that grain direction in what was basically a hook. And I've come to the conclusion since then that the Saxons, in just the same way that they would have grown knees for a boat to get the curve that they wanted, quite probably grew limbs for this purpose, by training the limb around a mould or a shape whilst it was growing. And so I've had to look to a different wood with different graining.
But the lyre was more than just a display of the artisan's craft, it was an essential element of Saxon folk memory.
Absolutely, they do alliterate brilliantly.
I think they'd run out of names, but and these are just the ones that happen to get preserved in writing.
Well, no, and as part of the lyre recreation, Sam and music archaeologist Graham Lawson are planning to compose an elegy, the oral equivalent of a tombstone.
How important was poetry to the Anglo-Saxons?
Absolutely central. It was a medium that had been evolving and being perfected for centuries before we see it trapped in writing. So it is the main medium at the time of the Prittlewell burial.
So it's almost a precursor to written history, isn't it? They're encoding the information in poetry before they're encoding it in formal historical records.
Exactly, and all constructed poetically, designed to be memorable, mnemonically structured, so that they would remember their genealogies, and the genealogies always had details of the king's place of death and his place of burial. So you end up with a kind of series of little obituaries in verse.
All that Sam needs now is a name. And in an attempt to get at least some agreement on who's buried at Prittlewell, Mick's assembled some of the leading participants for the first time to evaluate the evidence.
One thing that strikes me as interesting about this particular burial chamber is that it's less a burial chamber, more like a room.
The ideal potting shed, as it were. He's got all his vessels hung around the walls, sort of thing.
Yeah, in fact, the Coptic bowl, I'm sure that, you know, if we'd been brave enough or foolish enough, we could have excavated around it, and it probably still would have hung there. But right. Obviously, we didn't do that.
The two Christian kings who could have been interred at Prittlewell died almost 40 years apart, Sabert in 616 and Sigebert in the 650s. But no single find in the tomb has provided definitive dating evidence. However, the complete collection of symbolic, carefully laid out objects does suggest a time frame to the experts.
I think this particular combination of things, you could take an individual thing like the hanging bell, which the hanging bells do turn up later in the 7th century in Greece, but things like the Byzantine vessels, no, they do seem to be late 6th into very early 7th. The buckle type would fit comfortably in that range. The coins fit comfortably into that kind of range.
By 640, things would be a bit different.
Oh, this is very precise.
A buckle of that kind of size.
By 640?
Yeah, it would be unusual.
So what is our date range now?
It most comfortably fits, in my view, into the first quarter of the 7th century.
So 600 to 625. You're staking...
Yes!
The first quarter of the 7th century is too early for Sigebert the Saint's burial. In fact, it doesn't just cover the burial date of the Christian Sabert, but also his devoutly pagan sons. And there's further crucial evidence emerging from the archaeology.
So far, they look very much more like coffin fittings to me than bed fittings.
Liz has been working on the area of the tomb where the body was, and it seems there may have been two very different burial rituals.
Are those on top of the grave goods, those plank stains mentioned
Yes,
there?
I think so. I think they were on top of some of the small gold items, which also, although we don't have a body, that might suggest that they're over the top of the body rather than under it.
And this plan is after the roof structure had been taken away, so I suppose possibly that's more argument for a coffin lid.
Could be.
This seems to confirm that the body wasn't laid out on a bed, but buried inside a closed coffin. And that poses fascinating new possibilities.
What's in it is extremely simple. You've got a very simple belt buckle, two very plain gold crosses, and that's it. He's then sealed up in his coffin, carried to his grave, and is placed in a chamber which is furnished with all this kit. And I wonder whether that perhaps suggests two stages, which may give us a clue to the context of this
burial.
That's
a very interesting idea.
So it seems to be that it's a viewing of the tableau within the grave that's the important thing that the mourners come to look at.
Whoever was buried at Prittlewell was laid to rest by other people with their own beliefs. A low-key display of faith for a small group of witnesses, and then an exposed burial chamber proclaiming power and wealth could mean this was a Christian buried by pagans, or possibly a pagan buried by Christians. It seems the list of candidates could once again include Sabaoth's sons.
Knowing the political history and the history of Essex around about that time, I mean, you've given me some very precise dates for the range of objects you've got here. So the $64,000 question then is, do we have any confidence in saying who this individual is?
Even with all the available evidence, the experts fail to agree on an identity for the man buried at Prittlewell. But for one, the archaeology and history do offer enough clues to give a name to the Southend King.
I don't expect him to know.
Join a thriving worldwide community of Time Team fans on Patreon. Your ongoing membership enables us to develop more sites and more episodes.
It's almost a year since the Prittlewell burial was discovered, and as the hunt for the name of the king continues, the process of preparing the 140-plus items for exhibition is drawing to a close.
What I've had to do with this object is consolidate, sort of harden up a lot of the sand around the outside so that it holds all the ironwork in place because all the wood has disappeared. So the idea is that when people see the bucket, they notice the object before the gaps.
The recreation of the Prittlewell lyre is also nearing completion, a complex project that even with modern tools has proved to be a challenge for experienced instrument maker Zachary Taylor. The original highly fragile instrument is now undergoing further investigation at Mount Vernon Hospital in West London, where MOLAS have had the lyre block scanned to record the remains in 3D. And the scan reveals the lyre has obviously been lovingly and painstakingly repaired in more than one place.
It's as though they've stitched together the crack down the back of the instrument with these little double riveted plates.
Is there just one break?
Well, it's beginning to look as though there might be two or even three.
You don't think it would have affected the tone?
I think if they'd done it badly, it would have done. But what we'll need to do is to take Zachary's replica and take a hatchet to it and then get him to repair it. To test your theory, yes.
The lyre is just one of the objects that singled this tomb out as a burial of unique distinction. Individually, the finds are some of the finest examples of Anglo-Saxon craft, trade, and belief. Together, they celebrate the life of a king. And now, that king could have a name.
On the present evidence, we are almost certainly talking about King Sabaoth. If it's royal, If it's East Saxon, which all the indications are, it fits into those categories.
But why couldn't it have been later? Why couldn't it have been his grandson? Because certainly the vicar at Prittlewell reckons it was him.
We cannot rule out that Sigebert was involved in the development of the Christian site at Prittlewell. But as I understand it, the present archaeological evidence points to the earlier part of the 7th century.
Sabbat died in 616 AD, and the archaeology is key to Sam's deduction. The finds display the wealth and power of a king, while the spoon etched with a cross is just one of a number of objects with Christian connotations.
Here, est seax on fengen yeleavan.
This all ties in with Bede's account of Sabbert's conversion in 604.
Bishopper, loosely translated. Here in this year, the East Saxons received the faith and the baptismal bath. Under their king Sabbert, and Miletus, the bishop.
And then there are the gold crosses, a key piece of evidence in so much of this investigation.
The crosses, for me, are highly significant. The Latin form of them, the North Italian parallels archaeologically revealed, and the North Italian connection of Bishop Miletus, who, as I understand the sources, may well have been present at the funeral of King Sabbert. Shortly before he was so oot as shavon by the three Essex boys who succeeded, of course.
Sabbert's three sons' vehemently anti-Christian stance may also explain why the Prittlewell tomb appears to display two burial rituals. The simple gold crosses and belt buckle inside the coffin, respecting their father's beliefs, and a tomb packed with ostentatious displays of wealth, underlining the family's continuing power. The finds discovered at Prittlewell have catapulted Southend into the major league of Anglo-Saxon archaeology, suggesting it was a power base for the East Saxon kings and the burial ground of the man who helped found St Paul's Cathedral. The archaeologists from MOLAS are painfully aware of the impact of their discovery, especially as they could so easily have missed it.
Why did you put the trench in where you did?
We couldn't take the spoil off site, so...
Because of all the traffic?
Because of the traffic and so access of lorries and the fact that the spoil had to go back into evaluation trenches after we'd finished. Yeah. If we'd put it where I'd originally sort of planned to put it... Which was where we're standing, over here.
Yeah.
We would have missed the chamber grave completely.
So it was complete luck?
Yes.
Half a mile from the burial mound of Sabbert, another element of this fascinating archaeological and historical detective story is winding up.
And this is it. It's beautiful, isn't it?
At the church probably founded by Sabbert's grandson Sigebert, the new Prittlewell lyre is ready for its musical debut.
What's the science behind it? How does it work?
It's engineered in such a way that the vibration from the strings when you pluck is transmitted straight to the resonator here, and it's the vibration of this piece of wood, which is very, very thin, that gives you that nice, bright sound. And incidentally, that's the first time I've heard that, and that is a nice, bright sound.
Thank you.
You genuinely had not heard this before?
No, not at all. It's the first time I've seen it.
This church is the perfect place to celebrate King Sabbert's place in Essex and Saxon history with the specially composed elegy, performed in the old English language he would have spoken and sung.
Here is Sebectus Banhus, Restus under Beoria, Sladas Sunu, Fadas Sawiadas, Sax Radas, and Sax Balda.
Sabbert's bones rest under the barrow, Sladas son, father of Sawad, Sax Bald, and Sax Rad.
All the finds will eventually return to a new purpose-built museum in Southend, but even now, the Museum of London archaeologists are making new discoveries.
One of the latest things we found, it was sitting on top of the lyre. We've just cleaned it up, and as you can see, we actually have two spearheads. So it's one here and then one here.
The Prittlewell burial is still surprising the archaeologists.
You know what sticks in my head most, as an Essex man? Quite how cosmopolitan all those finds are. We've got Italy, we've got Germany, we've got Syria, and it all happened because of a lucky strike.
Well, yes, I mean, that's what I like about it. I mean, it was found by archaeologists who actually then did a fantastic job on it. so that it was all done in a way of getting the maximum information out of what was available to us.
And we've ended up by finding a new king.
Yeah, well, that can't be bad, can it?
Well, I don't know, for two grumpy old Republicans in a London pub, it's not the greatest news, is it?
I'll drink to that. Cheers, mate.
Sleepeth he now by the Prittle stream. This world he forsook, wise in winters. This lone life. Chose he another light, and his soul travelled to the home of the truthfast. Sleepeth he noo be Prittle's stream. This world for let, leave this land. Chaos him other layocht, we have his soul to hammer sooth faster.
Join Time Team on Patreon to access exclusive 3D models, masterclasses, and behind-the-scenes insights.